A very, very important indication for radio surgery. I'll fight for to do radio surgery in these cases. Well, our experience with gamma knife radio surgery now is more than 1 million patients treated during the last 30 years. Of those patients, more than 30% are benign tumors, and of those benign tumors, look, 30% of these tumors, of benign tumors, are vestibular schwannomas, more than 100,000, and the number of so-called non-vestibular schwannomas is 11% of these cases. We have mainly the group of trigeminal schwannomas, more than 6,000 patients treated all over the world, especially with gamma knife radio surgery. We have second group in this cooperative study. It has been included tumors from the cavernous sinus and the lower cranial nerves in these other schwannoma groups, so the so-called jugular foramen schwannomas. So in the second, the jugular foramen schwannomas is the second group in number of patients treated. Third one, it is the facial nerve, the cavernous sinus schwannomas, and then the facial nerves schwannomas. And I have to say that, especially in the group of facial nerves schwannomas and the cavernous sinus schwannomas, many cases misdiagnosed. Patients consider to have a vestibular schwannoma, they suffer from a facial schwannoma, and in the same with cavernous sinus, misdiagnosed with meningeal tumors. So, this is our experience. We have treated 1,160 schwannomas. We have taken away neurofibromatosis patients. In our statistics, we have included them in the other benign tumors, because these patients are very particular, and their clinical and pathological features merit a group apart to be discussed in a different way. The same decision has been taken in the majority of the series dealing with this topic. Talking about our experience in general with non-vestibular schwannomas, we have treated 63 cases from a total of 1,160 cases of schwannomas. So that means 5.4% of schwannomas treated are non-vestibular schwannomas, 5.7% of vestibular schwannoma, of the number of vestibular schwannomas treated. As I told you, some cases has been misdiagnosed, especially with facial and cavernous sinus schwannomas. The sex and age of the patient are similar to the vestibular schwannoma series. There is not any predominance of sex in this patient, and unlike the meningiomas, and the mean age varies from 10 to 77 years. More numerous group is the trigeminal nerve. Lower cranial nerve, jugular foramen schwannomas, it is 20% of the series. Cavernous sinus schwannomas is 70% of the series. Facial nerve, and we have in a case of C2, C3 root schwannoma case. I will talk later a few minutes about this case. Three cases has been previously operated, most of them trigeminal schwannomas. I'll discuss about the operation in these cases, and this is the radiosurgical data of these patients. We treat this tumor like vestibular schwannomas, same dose, and the evolution is quite well. We have a long follow-up, now more than 5 years follow-up, same volume, 19% reduction, 73%. One case has been operated, only one case, because it was an invasive tumor previously operated before the radiosurgery, and the patient needs another operation because the continuous growing of the tumor. There are few published series about this topic, and our results are very similar compared to those reported by the different authors. All authors emphasize the less morbidity observed after radiosurgery compared to surgical series. And in particular, the data of this series. Sorry, okay. The data are somehow earlier for many patients, and for this reason, less conclusive in the long term. We can now say that in our opinion, the long-term follow-up confirms the earlier observations of this group about the Kaplan-Meier long-term, 90% while 78% of the cases. We shall review each group of schwannomas. These are the trigeminal schwannomas. We have treated 34 patients, 6 patients operated on previously, and 80% are stable or have diminished in volume in this time. In 4 patients, the tumor has grown. This is the case I have already described. In 3 cases, 2 cysts, the tumor has grown up, but this growing does not need to be, this tumor has not been to be operated at the moment and have not required surgery at the last follow-up. This is a Gasserian ganglion schwannoma. We can find this tumor at the Gasserian ganglion or at the trigeminal roots of the nerve. This is the 8-year follow-up of the case, in this case. And this is our clinical experience. You can find facial sensitive deficits in all cases, no anesthesia dolorosa in any case. Dysesthesias are quite common and always appear after surgery. And I've seen 2 cases of trigeminal neuralgia. After radiosurgery, I have seen clinical improvement in 6 cases. This is important. It included 2 cases with the trigeminal neuralgia. This is an indication for cases with trigeminal neuralgia and tumors to be irradiated. Worsening 4 cases, no case of anesthesia dolorosa, this is important, and unchanged 70% of cases. And this is important to consider when we are indicating surgery or radiosurgery of these patients. These patients after surgery always have problems. This aesthetic can many, many, many problems. So we can treat this patient without causing more damage to the functional situation, and and even with causing damage in the periphery or necrosis. This is an example of a schwannoma of the trigeminal nerve expanding to the Gasserian ganglion. We can treat large volumes because most of these tumors are in the facial, and then we don't have here risk any risk structure to protect. So we have treated here tumors up to 15, 18, or 20 cubic centimeter in one fraction, in one incision. This is the follow-up of the patient 2 years after the radiosurgery. In cystic tumors, in this location, we can perform stereotactic drainage. Prior to radiosurgery, I have experience with 2 cases, and it is very effective and does not change the function of the nerve. So it can be done without not in a very with an orthogonal approach. By this way, in some patients, the same way we insert electrodes for the epileptic patients, for instance. Well, the published experience reflects very similar results with the same follow-up. That's confirmed the initial indication of radiosurgery in the majority of patients. Please have a look to the volume treated in this patient. Quite large, up to 38 cubic centimeter, not bad. The mean dose, the tumor control in these areas, and the clinical situation of this patient. When we talk about cavernous sinus, schwannomas, we have to consider the clinical features of the patient. And for the diagnosis of this patient, the clinical history, it is very important. Unless otherwise, we cannot diagnose the schwannoma. So in this case, we have 11 patients. In the third cranial nerve cases, we have confirmed by clinical signs these patients. They are patients who started with diplopia, ptosis, paresis, specific paresis of the third cranial nerve. Same for the fourth cranial nerve, and same for the abducens nerve. Another two cases has been confirmed by MRI. Specifically, MRI, this was the tumors located at the cistern in the anterior part of the brainstem. So there was the MRI diagnosis was clear. We have a long follow-up, and the evolution is even better than other groups of tumor. 100% of tumor were reduced or disappear. Clinical improvement, 7 cases, no change, 4 cases. And these are the operated patients. But no other side effects in these cases. And if we treat this patient as earlier as possible, we can protect the clinical, the functional situation of these patients. This is an example of the fourth cranial nerve schwannoma. From the point of view of the imaging, it is very difficult to localize. We have to rely on the clinical features of the patient. For this reason, I am sure that there are more patients treated and considered to suffer meningiomas, in the same with other indications, especially with the hemangiomas of the cavernous sinus. We cannot. For me, maybe you have more experience. For me, it is impossible designing either with diffusion and hemangioma, meningioma, or schwannoma. Difference: I've never seen an hemangioma patient with cranial nerve deficit in this situation. Meningioma has not so specific clinical features, while this is a patient with this lesion and specifically for cranial nerve paresis. So I'm sure that this patient and the evolution, the 10-year evolution, is very positive. So the series published with a small number of patients, and the results observed are the same, both with regard to the volume control and the clinical evolution of the patient. And the constant, you can see the data are very constant here. No. Clinical outcome, no change or improve, and volume has been reduced in all cases. The number of patients is quite limited, but no new deficit, stable tumor or reduction in all cases, and no side effects. And this is a case of cisplatin adduced nerve schwannoma, follow up 5 years later. Disappear. So as earlier as possible, we have to treat this patient, and we have considered, in my opinion, as the first choice radio surgery in these cases, if you are sure that you are with about the diagnosis. Well, jugular foramen schwannomas are the third group. These tumors are related with the 9, 10, 11, or 12 cranial nerves. And of course, we are able to diagnose the origin in some cases because of the clinical picture of the patient. Two patients have been operated on previously. And especially in jugular foramen schwannomas, we couldn't find the nerve of origin in 5 cases. And these cases were symptom-free. We know they are schwannoma because this patient has been operated on previously, or because later on they started with some specific symptoms. We have a long follow-up, and the result is better. Is similar to the other groups. Clinical improvement, 8 cases, no change, 5 cases, including the operated patients. Again, here, it is very important. We know it from the treatments of the glossopharyngeal that the cranial nerves at the jugular foramen can be irradiated in a quite safe way. So, you are irradiated with 80, 90 gray, the glossopharyngeal nerve, and no problem with the 10th cranial nerve or 12 or 11 cranial nerve. So it is quite safe to treat this even with large volumes. It is quite safe and very, very effective. This is an example of 10 cranial nerve schwannoma. Quite a difficult case for surgery. And very easy to be treated now in this by this procedure. The patient is symptom-free now with the same volume of the tumor. This is a case of glossopharyngeal schwannoma. Again, again symptoms. Quite a large tumor. A tumor, it is reduced 2 years later. The patient is symptom-free now. And this is a case of jugular foramen schwannoma. We know it, but because the patient has been operated on and the diagnosis has been an schwannoma, but we couldn't see any clinical symptoms related to this tumor, except hearing impairment of the patient. The patient started with hearing impairment and was diagnosed by this way. He came to my outpatient clinic. I was not convinced about the just a direct radio surgery. The patient has been operated on very partial resection. It was confirmed that was an schwannoma. No problem with the acoustic or vestibular schwannoma. I mean, it was the MRI was fully, and we treated the patient. The patient remained with hearing impairment, with no other signs. Again, the series published about this tumor confirms the good prognosis of this tumor after radiosurgery at long term. Note that the tumor volume treated is quite large, and very good prognosis with a large median R about control of this tumor. And pre-existing symptoms improve in a very, very significant percentage. And this is a cooperative study with 170 patients treated, the larger one in the world. This is the actual. Note that we are talking from 10 years to 20 years follow-up of this patient. No changes from 8 years follow-up, and the actual is maintained over all this time. And this is our experience also, at the long term. You see? No changes. You have some changes in the 2-3 years follow-up, but after 8-7 years, it is very stable, the evolution of this patient. The same with us, with vestibular, with other schwannomas. And this is an example of a jugular foramen schwannoma operated 10 years before. It grows again, and it has been treated by us in 2009. And this is the tumor now, 8 years post-radiosurgery. That one. In this case, like Constantin talked about the person, it is very important not only treating the tumor, this is a surgical point of view when we treat this patient, not only treating the tumor, but treating all the cavity related to the tumor. Because this is, especially in schwannomas, this is tumor too. So we included all the cavity related to the tumor. We protect the brain stem. As Ian Paddick told, brain stem is quite easy, the protection of the brain stem, no problem. In such a way, now we can see any enhancement surrounding the tumor. Very good evolution. Well, facial nerve schwannomas. This group of tumor, for me, is particularly important because I am convinced that we have misdiagnosed a few cases. The symptoms related are hemifacial spasms, especially with the geniculoid ganglion, because facial schwannomas has different origin. Why I see that we have treated the Brisbane nerve schwannoma, this special rupture, because the patient suffered exclusively from hypoesthesia of the anterior part of the tongue. This is specific of this nerve. Geniculate ganglion schwannomas, it is specific. Hemifacial spasms, patients who come to the outpatient clinic with hemifacial spasms, followed by facial paresis, they by sure suffer, of course, a facial schwannoma and probably originated at the geniculate ganglion schwannoma. And we have a case of, I'll show you, of subtemporal facial nerve. It was a large tumor in the subtemporal region, operated on, and we find it an schwannoma. So here, clinical features are very important. In many cases, a patient comes to the clinic and he describes just quite an episode of hemifacial spasm. We see the case, we do the MRI, you suffer a vestibular schwannoma. Let's to treat the patient, or even worse, wait and see. And in this particular group of patients, it is very important the hearing impairment. If they do not suffer hearing impairment before radiosurgery, they will maintain the hearing. If they already suffer hearing impairment, they will lose the hearing possibility. And the hearing impairment appears in a very fast way, and they lose hearing in a very fast way. So it is very important to recognize this patient and to treat this patient as soon as possible. The prognosis is very good, 100% stable or shrunk, and clinical improvement is very significant in these cases. I mean clinical improvement. 1% probability of control hemifacial spasm. If they suffer from facial paresis, it is maintained. But in my experience, and I'll show you the published series, you can, this patient do not develop after the radiosurgery facial paralysis, and you can maintain the hearing of this patient. This is an example of this tumor. We suspect another thing, we suspect a meningioma. It has been operated, it was a schwannoma. The patient was suffer facial paralysis, it was Brugman grade 3, and hearing was maintained, was conserved. So we treat the patient quite a long time ago, 12 years ago, and the volume is the same, but the patient maintain the facial function, that does not change, and he suffers cervical hearing. This is an example of the schwannoma originated at the geniculate ganglion. If you go to an ORL surgeon or maybe some of our colleagues, the decision will be, well, if you find a tumor just here, at the geniculate ganglion, the decision will be, well, why don't we wait to see what happened? We have to wait to develop a severe facial paralysis and later on operate on the patient and make a graft of the nerve. Nowadays, sorry for telling that, nowadays this is not the right way of treating this patient. This is not the right way, because we can maintain facial function in this patient, hearing function in this patient, and we can treat them in a very, very easy way. So radiosurgery indication of these cases is mandatory. Sorry for telling this in that way, but it is. I want to give you a clear message. This is the case of the Brisbane intervening nerve. Is this case. Hemifacial spasm and hypoesthesia in the anterior part of the tongue. Only signs. Fortunately, this patient came with just hearing impairment, and it is a lady, he has lost their hearing, he has been followed up for 9 years by now. She has lost hearing by almost, she doesn't maintain cervical hearing, but it is in house Brugman now, nowadays just level 1, no hemifacial spasm. This is a recent series about surgical management of intrinsic tumors of the facial nerve. They conclude, in patients with good facial nerve function, house Brugman 1, 2, with an scan approach is recommended. And this is published this year by our colleagues. In case where the facial nerve has been interrupted during surgery, the cable nerve has been interposed. So you have a lot of experience with radiosurgery. In the discussion, I would like to ask you your experience about these tumors. But it merits from the European group a cooperative study like the Japanese has done, or even the Chinese, to make a large series about these tumors and to have enough evidence to avoid this. Well, this is the largest series. This is the cooperative study I told you about the Japanese experience, 42 patients treated. And this is partial remission, total remission, 92% probability at more nowadays, more than 12 years follow-up, controlling or reducing the tumor. Hearing function improve and remain stable in 85% of cases. Facial nerves improve in 90%, remain unchanged, and worse in just 12% of cases. and consider the 29 patients with gamma knife radiosurgery at initial treatment, 21 suffer from were improved facial partial, and 61 remain stable. So this is a clear conclusion, and it is a clear alternative to resection. Sorry, this is the case of the C2 schwannoma. I have to say that it is a very easy case to be treated by CyberKnife radiosurgery. So it is a good indication also for CyberKnife radiosurgery. We treat patients with gamma knife or CyberKnife radiosurgery. In this case, I treat the with gamma knife because at that time we couldn't. CyberKnife was not available. Nowadays, we can treat the patient in both ways. The indication is excellent for this for both cases. This is the follow-up 2 years, 30% reduction of the tumor. Again, in the cervical, in the upper cervical spine, you know, the partial resection followed by radiosurgery, it is a clear indication. Especially gamma knife, CyberKnife in these cases work in the whole spine in a very, very, very proper way. So this is the conclusions, very simple conclusions. These benign tumors are not so uncommon as was considered. The problem is many people does not pay so many attention to the, let's say, clinical signs, because most of the tumor has to be diagnosed from the clinical point of view. You have a mass, you discover a mass. Sorry for telling mass. You discover a mass in the, and if you can do the right study, you can check this, you can diagnose this tumor. These are lesions that usually take to produce symptoms, especially the trigeminal nerve schwannomas or the jugular foramen schwannomas. They are symptom-free and can be confused, of course, with more frequent tumors in the same location, but they are, even with large volume, excellent indication for radiosurgery. The response is very positive, and in my opinion, is the first treatment option in most cases, because we have to consider the functional evolution of this patient. The only way of maintaining the functional evolution of this patient, because we are talking about tumors of the seat of the nerve. So, especially in the facial nerve, any surgical, if you really operate on the tumor, you make a functional damage in the nerve. And in the trigeminal nerve, for instance, these ischias are very, very, very bothering. Well, thank you very much for your attention.